Welcome to the Azure Cosmos DB Essential Series Season 2. My name is Mustafa. I'm a product marketing manager for Azure Cosmos DB. And in the last episode, we walked through some things to know when choosing an API, as well as introduced some concepts we need to understand on day one of using Azure Cosmos DB. This episode, we'll explore the topic of the request unit, which are fundamental to pricing and capacity planning in Cosmos DB. So let's start with a question. What is a request unit? A request unit is a unit of compute and is how Azure Cosmos DB charges for database operations. Whenever you make a request into the database, so let's say we have a request that goes into the database and a response that comes back out, and our request is a query, for example, hey database, find me all the information where the first name is Andrew. What you're really doing is you're in the backend using up some CPU, memory, and IOPS, or input-output operations. Now, the game we're usually playing here is capacity planning. So if you look at a virtual machine, you can usually manipulate each of these three dimensions. You can increase the amount of cores, you can increase memory in terms of gigabytes of RAM, or with IOPS, you can typically look at whether you have a hard disk, an SSD, or an array of any of them. For a lot of different vendors, including some of our Azure services, when working with virtual machines, what we'll do is we'll give these three things, CPU, memory, and IOPS in the form of different managed disks with, for instance, 4 cores, 8 gigabytes of RAM, etc. When capacity planning, there are a couple of characteristics of request units that make the approach different to working with traditional VMs. So first, let's look at virtual machines. The first thing we need to do is determine the right size machine for our app. So how much of these three things, CPU, memory, and IOPS, are needed for our use case? Now, mixing these factors plus storage offers different database performance characteristics, but figuring out exactly how much of each to provision can be difficult. The goal of request units is to make capacity planning simple. So what we do is establish that 1RU is going to be equal to 1 point read of 1 kilobyte of data as a rule in Cosmos DB. And with that rule in mind, we can now determine how many request units we need to provision. If you run a query that returns, say, twice as much information, what you'll see is that double the RUs are going to be used. RUs are Azure Cosmos DB's logical currency. So let's go through an example of how capacity planning is simpler with the concept of a request unit. If I have a workload that has 100 reads per second and, I don't know, 200 writes per second, if it takes, say, 4 RUs per read and 8 RUs per write, then the amount of overall compute that's needed for this on the read path at 100 reads per second is going to be 400 request units. And on the write path, at 200 writes per second, we're going to need 1,600 request units. That puts our capacity planning result at 2,000 request units per second. Now, this is obviously a simple example, but we actually have a pricing calculator that lets you input the document size, number of reads, inserts, updates, writes, deletes, etc., with all of the RU approximations for each operation already populated. This allows for us to just fill in what we know about the size of the data we're reading and how many reads or writes we think our application is going to need in order to get a more granular estimation. Additionally, you can also just upload a sample document to the calculator, fill out a few fields, and it'll throw you an RU estimation, which is pretty cool. This granular estimation is really only necessary when provisioning manually, and we offer a few different provisioning models, such as serverless and autoscale, that eliminate the need to do such an exact estimation. So what are the characteristics of an app workload that might make you lean toward one model over another? To answer that, we'll start at the very top level. Cosmos DB offers a provision throughput model as well as a serverless model. Within the provision throughput model, there's a few things you'll want to think about, which are whether you want to manually configure the RUs versus turn on autoscale. Now, starting with serverless, the more simple option, it's a consumption-based model where over the lifetime of the month, it's going to bill based on the number of requests consumed. So if I, over the course of the month, ran only 2 queries, and those 2 queries cost, let's say, 5 RUs each, then I will, over the lifetime of the month, have consumed 10 RUs. With serverless priced at 25 cents per million RUs, it's pretty cheap to use serverless. Now, I can also configure the Cosmos DB account for provisioned throughput, in which case, when we go and create our database, both databases and containers can have a manual amount of provision throughput or an auto-scaling amount of provision throughput. Manual provision throughput will bill for the number of provisioned requests, regardless of how many are consumed, and autoscale will bill for the peak number of requests received within an hour window. So if you have 100 requests during an hour, and then 10 requests the next hour, the first hour will be billed as if manually provisioned at 100 requests, and the second hour will be billed as if manually provisioned for 10 requests at that hour. To understand when we should use one over the other, I'll illustrate this with a graph. Now imagine that I have a graph here, where the x-axis is, of course, time, and the y-axis is the number of requests per second. If the shape of my graph looks something like this, let's say I have a dev test workload where most of the time it's idle, but once in a while, I'm developing in the morning, I run some queries, and then it's idle, and then I go to lunch, run a few queries, and then in the afternoon, I run some queries again. But over time, I find that a good amount of my work doesn't always need a live database. The utilization, if I look at this graph, is fairly low. Like, I have these intermittent spikes, but otherwise, the workload is pretty much idle. It may be a dev test workload, or it may even be a line of business application in production. In the second graph, let's say I have a live website where I always have some traffic. But then suddenly, my application makes the front page of Reddit, and so I'm getting a lot more traffic. Then, over time, the traffic fades after the initial burst. In this third graph, we're going to look at, let's say I have an IoT device telemetry scenario with a message queue and a growing number of devices. Let's say 1,000 devices that grows to 2,000 devices that grows to 3,000 devices. But nonetheless, what happens is the workload's predictable and just sends a heartbeat every second. Today, when I have 1,000 devices, I can approximate that to be just 1,000 requests per second, and then accounting for some network latency and jitter. But for the most part, the throughput on that is going to be very flat. When I look at each of these scenarios, we notice the shape of each curve looks very different. Now, if I were to go in, look at the last graph, the IoT device telemetry scenario, this one is something where we can give it a guaranteed performance by manually provisioning throughput based off what the workload needs are at that time. Now, in the middle scenario, what you notice here is this is the live website that gets like a big social media bomb. If I were to do manually provisioned throughput, what you'll notice is that there's a lot of waste here. So this isn't the most cost-effective way to provision in this case. By using autoscale, what we can do is we can put an upper threshold on how much traffic we want the database to be able to support. And what Cosmos DB autoscale does is it actually scales at 10x scaling range and automatically scales throughput within that range. So if I go and set autoscale rather than a provision model for the peak, if I set this as the max of my autoscale, then what I'll do is the actual will look something like this, and all of this difference between the max versus the actual is the amount of money that autoscale can save our workload. In the first scenario, this might look like a time when we want to use autoscale as well. But what's happening is, because we have these large periods of idle, and autoscale never goes down to zero as part of the performance proposition of a provisioned throughput model, with serverless, we decide to say we don't need guaranteed throughput when our workload's at zero. What we're looking for is most of the time, the database is going to be idle. What we like to do is pay based off the consumed request, and that's it. So again, serverless is a really cost-effective way to run production and dev test workloads with intermittent throughput needs. Now, with the manually provisioned throughput model from the IoT scenario, let's talk about whether we should be provisioning at the container or database level. If we're in the portal, we just created an account, and underneath the account, you have a database and three containers, containers 1, 2, and 3. If we provision at the container level, then we are in essence binding the container to a set of one or more nodes serving requests, and we'll effectively call these partitions, which we'll cover in the next episode on partitioning. If we provision 5,000 RUs to container 1 and 25,000 RUs to the other two containers, then we effectively provision 10,000 RUs between our three containers. If we do the provisioning at the database level, then we can provision 10,000 RUs to be shared across those three containers, tying the database to a few nodes rather than a single container. Typically speaking, in most scenarios, what we end up seeing is you'll have one container that's very large, and then you have many small metadata containers, and what we advocate for is having the small container share a database level throughput and having the one large container have its own dedicated throughput. All right, so that concludes the second episode about request units, capacity planning, and the difference between different provisioning models in Cosmos DB. Tune into the next episode on partitioning strategy to learn more about things to know on day one of getting started with Cosmos DB.